Paulo Dybala, once seen as the future of Juventus, now being told that his future lays elsewhere. There's a ton to consider when trying to give an explanation as to why exactly Juve want to get rid of him, which we'll explain here, or try to at least, including Juve's change in tactics last season that will evolve yet again under Maurizio Sarri, and Dybala's downward trend that started in the 17-18 season. What's up, I'm Adrian, and this is Rabona TV. If you're new around here, then consider subscribing, as we like to do some longer form, research-heavy videos like our Roots of the Rivalry series, and different explainers that will be mixed in with all of the current events of the upcoming season as well. In fact, speaking of research-heavy videos, I have a player bio on Paulo Dybala, his upbringing, his Polish ancestry, losing his father, his time in Argentina, his transfer to Palermo, and the first few seasons with Juve. Definitely worth a watch if you want to see his background. I'll link to it in the comments. But in this video, we're talking about Dybala now, in present day. Why are we talking about him? Because of his rumored deal that would send him off to Manchester United or Inter Milan in exchange for a striker. That's what the media has been talking about lately, with the most prominent rumors linking him with a move to Old Trafford in exchange for Romelu Lukaku. But there have been some other reports of sending him to Antonio Conte's Inter Milan in exchange for Mauro Icardi, whom Conte has said is not in the team's plans at all for this upcoming season. He got the Diego Costa treatment. Now, Dybala has no interest in leaving Juventus to go to either Inter or Manchester United, if you're to believe reports from his camp. He's apparently hurt by Juve trying to push him out, and has spoken to Sarri and said that he intends to stay and prove himself at Juve. But allegedly, Fabio Paratici, sporting director at Juve, is trying to convince Paulo Dybala to accept a move abroad, with the swap with Manchester for Lukaku seeming to be the favorite option. It's worth keeping in mind, swap deals are always thrown out there in the media, but are extremely rare due to the two players having to agree terms and thus holding some power in the deal. But the question is, should Juventus go with Lukaku over Dybala, and what has led them to this point where one of the biggest talents in the game is suddenly expendable to a team with Champions League winning aspirations? Let's talk about positioning and his favored role within a team. Well, if you're familiar with Dybala's career or you just watched my in-depth player bio on him, then you'll know that he operates best as a sort of a second striker or deep-lying striker. He certainly does have surprising pace to him, as he can run onto balls played in behind the defenders, but in doing so, you're not really getting the most out of Paulo Dybala. You're almost letting his best attributes go unused: his control, his long shot, and dribbling. Paulo Dybala is best when he has the ball at his feet. He can pluck the ball out of the air with ease with his left boot. He can dribble his way out of tight corners, surrounded by opponents, and with the space that he finds himself in after, can either lash a decent strike on goal or play a killer ball through to one of his overlapping teammates. While his position is technically a central one, when he's at his best, he has the freedom to roam from the middle to the right side a little bit. And in doing so, allows him, of course, to cut in on his favored left foot. An example of how he can be dominant in this role was his match against Barcelona in the 2017 UEFA Champions League quarterfinals, scoring a brace in a 3-0 win at home, wrapping his left boot around the ball to curl one into the far post from the right, and then stepping into a cutback at the top of the box from his other favorite position, central, coming in late just behind the striker. Dybala is a bit of a tough player to nail down positionally, as he has been played as an out-and-out striker before both at Juve and Palermo, but he's best when he's floating as a second striker, deep-lying striker, I'd say. His successes with Juventus have come from this sort of role. His first season was undoubtedly his best as far as goal involvement goes, pitching in on 28 goals in the Serie A alone. Remember, that's assists and goals scored combined. He had a noticeable drop-off in his second season, but in the 2017-18 season, he contributed a lot of goals once again. But this is where the twist is. It wasn't a perfect season for him, as his number one enemy throughout his career so far, inconsistency, reared its head during the 2017-18 season. And while some say that he struggled during the 2018-19 season due to the arrival of Ronaldo, there were signs of a downward trajectory before Ronaldo had even arrived. So at the start of the 17-18 season, Dybala was absolutely flying, tearing apart every opponent that came his way, scoring volleys, curling strikes from distance, free kicks with his incredible left boot, you name it, he was pulling it off. In the league alone, he scored 10 goals in the first 6 matches of the season. Extremely impressive if not for the fact that he ended up with 22 goals that season. An impressive feat, yes, double digits, but there were large periods of inconsistency in Dybala's play, with hat tricks coming against inferior opposition early in the season and in the last quarter, making up the bulk of his goals. The only big teams he scored against were Milan and Lazio. No goals against Napoli, Roma, Inter, etc. in the league. In the Champions League, he returned to Juve's lineup and scored the decisive goal to send them through against Tottenham, but got himself sent off against Real Madrid in the first leg of the quarterfinals. He scored one goal from eight Champions League appearances in that 17-18 season. So it felt like when Juve really needed him, Dybala's performances didn't quite match up to expectation. There was a stretch from November to about January-February where Dybala would find himself benched due to a lack of form, with vice president of the club Pavel Nedved saying that, quote, "He's 24, and it's normal that he has ups and downs, and obviously he's a player who could get to the very top. I'd advise him to focus on his football and make lots of sacrifices in his private life and train to the maximum." End quote. And Allegri added on a later date that, quote, "I'm sorry about leaving him out because he's a young lad with a lot of quality, but I'm not leaving him on the bench because he's rubbish. Maybe some of the comparisons that have been made have damaged him because players should only really be judged after they've made a certain number of appearances. Too much responsibility has been placed on him, but the club are very close to Paulo." End quote. So as you can see here, and as you probably already knew, there's absolutely no question as to the quality of Paulo Dybala. Everyone knows he has it, and while his goal haul was technically his second best at Juve during the 17-18 season, it left a little bit to be desired as far as the strength of his performances in matches when he wasn't scoring. And then, Juventus signed Ronaldo. When a goal scorer like Cristiano Ronaldo comes to your club, typically you would build a system around him that would give him the best possible chance at scoring as many goals as possible. So, Allegri's favorite way of playing was with Ronaldo and Mandzukic up front in a sort of 4-4-2, with tons of balls being whipped into the box for Ronaldo to head home, with crosses coming in from Cancelo and the like. For Dybala, he just didn't fit into this system. When Ronaldo would roam into the middle, Mandzukic would push to the vacant left, meaning Dybala could only go to the right, but Cancelo's already there. So he no longer had his drifter position in the middle, and he couldn't really operate on the right either. Unfortunately for Juve, their first season with Ronaldo wasn't the most inspiring, and the only piece of silverware they won was the Scudetto. Perhaps one of the most worrying things that season, though, was the problem that Dybala and Ronaldo seemingly had in playing together, or at least being effective together. Dybala had his worst season by far thanks to the shift in tactics, scoring a paltry 5 goals in the Serie A. Though he did improve his Champions League numbers, scoring 5 in the group stage before Juve was later eliminated in the competition by Ajax, 4 of those 5 goals were against young boys from Switzerland, though. So, 30 appearances in the Serie A, 5 goals, 4 assists. A far cry from his 22 goals and 5 assists from the year prior, where his downward trajectory had started. Again, following the theme of scoring against the weaker clubs, even in the Champions League. Then, once he was in the shadow that Ronaldo casts, he did not rise to the occasion. His teammate Bernardeschi said, quote, "Ronaldo can cast a shadow or be a stimulus. I took the second route, silently tried to grab everything I saw. I'm happy with the good relationship we have." End quote. Seemingly, at least last season, Dybala fell into the shadow rather than letting Ronaldo be a stimulus for him. So, with Maurizio Sarri wanting to implement his now infamous, or just famous, 4-3-3 formation at Juventus, it bears the question, where does Dybala fit in? Bernardeschi seems to think that he already has that right wing spot nailed down, and he might do because he likes to come back and help on defense, with Ronaldo on the left and the striker position up for grabs. Higuain and Dybala could fight for it at this point, though it is believed that Paratici is trying to convince Dybala to accept a move away as a make weight for another striker signing. Apparently he's doing the most to get him to accept that United deal. If they are really trying to get a swap deal for Dybala and Lukaku, are they really improving their squad? I mean, yes, Dybala's season was horrible last year, but there's no doubt about his ability. And with Lukaku, you know that you're getting the same sort of goal output that Dybala supplies. He'll get into double digits, and he'll do it by scoring against the little guys in the league. Who knows? Perhaps his physicality could lead Lukaku to be one of the best strikers in the Serie A. So, to give up on a talent like Dybala to bring in players that are inferior skill-wise, to me at least, seems a bit strange on Juve's part, but the harsh reality, I guess, is you can't win silverware on the promise of great potential in certain players. You need the performances to match up with it. Dybala had two seasons where he scored 20 plus goals and two where he didn't, with last season being especially forgettable. One of those seasons that he scored 20 plus goals in also saw him ride the bench for stretches due to a lack of form. For all of these reasons, Juve see the potential to cash in as they want to make the most of these last few seasons they have with Ronaldo in the front line to get that Champions League title. So as the thumbnail says, Dybala's brilliant, but far, far, far too inconsistent. But would I personally swap Lukaku for Dybala? Not that my opinion matters, but no. I would try to find a system for him to flourish in alongside Ronaldo, but we all know that Sarri has no interest in catering to specific players. It's all about the system for him, and therein lies the problem for Dybala. Oh, and one last thing about Dybala. He's not exactly an assist king either. He's not directly involved in goals for his teammates too often, which is a bit of a misconception surrounding him. That's not really his role. He's a goal scorer. His best haul for assists was when he was with Palermo, with 10, and he has notched less and less with every passing season at Juve. So, that's it. Thank you to everyone who voted on my poll the other day asking what you thought about Dybala. 3,500 of you voted, and while not consistent enough was the runaway leader with 57%, 35% of you said he was brilliant, while just 8 of you said that he was overrated. 8% of you, that is. And this is pretty much exactly how I feel as well, as you know by now. Brilliant, but way too inconsistent. If he is able to sort that out, then he will always be in the conversation for the top 5 players in the world. I'm sure of it. Thanks for watching. I hope you enjoyed this video, and if you did, then a like is appreciated. My name is Adrian. I love you, and I'll see you soon. Later.